Morning. I'm Claire Reddington. I'm the Creative Director of Watershed. I'm chairing today, and I'll keep our speakers in line with my honker if they go over time. And if there's any nonsense from the audience, you might get honked too. We have a live stream this morning. Hello to anyone watching on the live stream. If you've got any questions that you want me to relay, you can tweet me at Claire Red, and I'm going to be looking at my Twitter for that reason, not just generally checking my email. So Claire Red is C-L-A-R-E-R-E-D if anyone wants to put a question. So welcome to the Metro Mayor Hustings for the creative technology sector. I'm really glad I got asked to do this actually, because the whole thing massively confused me. So having to sit down and think about what does this mean and what does it mean for our sector has been really great. As I'm sure all of you who've read, digested and memorised the manifesto know, and the TechNation 2017 report showed that the sector contributes 8 billion to the local economy, and it's the third largest in the UK. So the vision is to be a globally leading creative technology centre, and we're going to hear today how these guys are thinking about how they're going to deliver that for us by 2020. But I thought I'd start with what is a Metro Mayor. I might get some of this wrong, so you can heckle me, candidates, or floor. But it is kind of confusing. So the Metro Mayor is really a coordinating position across the three counties of Bristol and Bath, South Gloss. Hello, is that better? Okay, so it's a coordinating position across the three counties, Bristol, Bath and South Gloss. They'll have responsibility for post-16 skills and business support, I've heard this morning from Nick, transport and housing, and have a budget of 30 million. And some responsibility for the LEP, but we might bottom out what that actually means in the Q&A, because I think that bit's still fairly unclear to me. It's the main strategic lead for negotiations with the government, and I think the main lead on economic development for the region. They'll chair a cabinet made up of the leaders or mayors of the three authorities. And to get anything passed, they will need a majority on that cabinet. So that's really why it's a kind of facilitation, coordination leadership role, not a kind of straight down hierarchy at the front making decisions role. So we might want to bear that in mind. Have I got all this right so far?
But from North East Somerset is included as well as Bath.
It is, I'm sorry, Bath and North East Somerset. We haven't asked the candidates to give us a kind of open speech this morning. We've asked them instead to respond to the 10 kind of asks of them about how they will realise our vision for the creative technology sectors. So there's 10 of them, and we've asked them to spend 5 minutes thinking about one or two of them, how it speaks to them and how they will seek to deliver that as part of their role in the region. The bright people amongst you will notice we're missing two of the candidates this morning. I'm not allowed to make any jokes about that.
Could I just say Stephen Williams is on a train and will be here in 5 minutes?
Yeah. We're missing one candidate this morning, and I won't make any jokes about that. So, we are going to go in alphabetical order by first name, as you will see, skipping Aaron Foote of UKIP and the empty chair. And we're going to start with Darren. And Darren, I'm going to give you 5 minutes to respond to that brief. You do. Thanks.
Okay, good morning, everybody. Thanks very much. Actually, 5 minutes is a huge luxury. Normally, it's 2 minutes or even 1 minute to get us started. I'll get directly to the point rather than doing any sort of preamble about me and all that political malarkey, because I think you're here for a very specific reason. And get into this idea about smart cities and technology and what's it all for, why are we doing it, why would I be interested in pushing it as an agenda. Now, I actually have a website that is called Smart Living, and so one of my challenges, one of my things that I would like to talk about this morning with regard to this sort of smart cities tech debate is the breadth of the concept of smart. And I think that technology is brilliant. I'm an engineer by background, I'm a mechanical engineer, I like to, you know, my secret shame as a Green Party person is I quite like Formula One still. Because of the technology, because of the engineering, because of the science that's in all of these processes that can help us make progress. But my hesitation about it is, what are we using all of this technology for? It should be a means to an end, not an end in itself. So the reason I've started talking about smart living rather than smart cities is about what is it all for. So this is a slightly random example of what I mean, but hopefully you'll bear with me. When I say that I think organic milk is smart. Why do I say that? Well, I believe that organic milk is smart for the cows. It's smart for the farmers because they can get a decent gate price for it. It's smart for the soil because it's better for the soil. It's smart for the system within which all of this operates. It's also actually smarter for business because right now we're selling milk at such a low price that the farmers are going out of business. Now that can't be called smart on any level, no matter how much technology you pile into the process of producing milk to be able to get it to customers. You can have all the apps you like, but if you're selling it at a price that is unaffordable for the system and unaffordable for the, in particular from my perspective, the planetary system to deal with, then it's not smart. So Bristol has got this opportunity to be a global leader. When you look across the economy of the West of England, it is remarkably diverse. It's got the potential to lead the circular economy, the potential to lead in the resilience agenda as well. There's a fantastic report recently from the Rockefeller Foundation that Bristol was a member of. Because this is about the next 50 years for the economy, not the next 6 months. And I think that's one of the other real strengths of the creative tech sector, is that you've got that moulding of art and thought and future that is saying, look, let's look beyond the end of our nose and let's look to where the economy and where people want to be in 50 years' time. Now, if you add into that tech creative expertise that we've got a fantastic finance sector in Bristol, Bath, we've got an amazing engineering sector, we've got the most number of environmental lawyers outside of London here in the West of England. And one of the things that I think we could do a lot better is to bring various bits of that expertise together to really innovate above and beyond what other core cities and other cities around the world are saying. Because right now, I think there are some cities around the world who really are saying very bold things about the agenda for 50 years' time. And I think there's a slight danger that the West of England is, as a collective economy, not bold and big enough about where it wants to be in the next generation of things that are going on. And I'll finish by saying, what I'd simply like to do as a Green Party representative is to make sure that all of that is within the context of balancing people, planet and profit. Because if we don't balance those things, ultimately we are all setting ourselves up to fail. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, before we go on to John. Morning, Stephen.
I made a mistake of coming by train.
Oh. Okay, great. So, John, let's hear your 5 minutes on what you're going to do for the creative technology sector and this manifesto.
Thank you very much. There's a danger in this election that we all say the same things because, of course, our real tasks are very narrow, although they have a broad effect. So I'm just delighted to be able to sit and talk to you about what you do. And if it reflects on what I can do for you, that would be great. But I'm very interested in what you do. This job is about the economy. Our life is about the economy. And if anybody's involved in the economy of the future, you lot, and there is no question about that. And I think that one of the problems that we have here in Bristol, in Greater Bristol, is that we have a sort of weird double problem. We're a bit complacent. I don't suppose you are, but generally we have a complacency, that has permeated my life here for nearly 40 years. And we also don't shout out what we're good at enough. And amongst other things that I still do, I'm the chairman of Destination Bristol. That's selling Bristol as a destination that people come to for all sorts of reasons, not least the sort of work that you do and the things that you're involved with, for tourism or whatever. And of course, it keeps getting, the place gets continuous accolades for being a great place to come to. It's a very young place. I'm particularly interested in the opportunities with the work that you do because of, and I'm not pandering to you, believe me, but because there is a sort of natural lateral thinking that goes with your work that for me frees up, and you're already doing it, some of you, a better approach to young people and their chances in life. It seems to me that all those of you that I know are very prepared to look for talent in places where the system doesn't expose it, and you're prepared to invest in it. And that is really important because we waste young people's talent all the time. We've gone continuously through a process of disregarding about 25% of young folk who are deeply separated from society because of their lack of family opportunity. It seems to me, from what I look at, that you're prepared to look at people at face value and to give them chances, and that is going to be vital, because I was chairman of the Learning and Skills Council for Greater Bristol and for the West Country whilst it existed for 10 years. That was looking after post-16 education. We had a lot of money. It was just one long uphill struggle to try to get colleges in particular to understand that they've got to think a bit further over the horizon to prepare young people for the work of tomorrow, not of the immediacy. And so when they closed the Learning and Skills Council, we were still, and I'm not pouring scorn on this, we were still training people to be hairdressers when we should have been training young people in things that could excite them about the reason why they should be working. We need to get those young folk involved in our economy. So I'm very interested in that, and I applaud you for what you're doing. Part of the mayor's job, as I said, is to sell the place and to sell what goes on here, both in the UK, of course, and Europe, and around the world. And my goodness, you've already got a fantastic platform of success. The other thing that really interests me, with another hat on, I'm still the chairman of the hospital just here in Bristol. We have about 9,000 employees. Technology, communication, innovation in those things is absolutely vital. And many of you will know that in the health service, we cannot get it right in being able to have the records of patients, for example, in the same format, at the desks all over the place. So some GPs can look at what we've got at the hospital, some can't. I can look at the stuff that's going on in my hospital. We're trying to help with Western Hospital. No chance of overlap with the record keeping they get. And that is vital to the health of the people that we're looking after. Because actually, the cures that we do, the fixing, is getting relatively easy. You know, the advances have been made, again, partly because of your industries, are amazing. But we fail in communication all the time. And we're late in diagnosis, we're late in passing information backwards and forwards to the doctor. So I'm really interested in what you do there. So I find this exciting. I'm just glad to have been able to come and talk to you. I've gone on too long.
No, you were. That's great. I was giving you a 1 minute. I've not honked you. I'm very impressed with both of you so far.
So, Leslie, that's it for you.
Thank you. Is this the mic's working? Yeah, can I hear me? I'm going to stand up because smart as it is, this chair's not very comfortable.
Yeah.
So I'm going to stand up. My name is Leslie Mansell. I'm the Labour Co-operative Party candidate for Metro Mayor for the West of England. And I actually work in the NHS. I'm an equality manager. And I've worked as an equality manager for quite some time now. I've done that in higher education, university. I've done that in local government. And I've also worked in the voluntary sector. But I did 11 years in engineering. Again, it was mechanical engineering. What we made was clocks and fire alarms and bells. You may have heard of the company. It's called Gents. It still exists. When I first went to work there, there were 4 drilling alleys in the machine shop, which is the shop that I managed. And there was a man, and it was a man, stood behind every drill. When I left, there was one, 11 years later. When I went there, you would get a sheet of metal, you would take it down to the big press, You would cut out all the pieces for the clock. You would drill it, turn it, mill it, and you make all the pieces to assemble a clock. And some of our clocks you'll see, for example, on the Liver building in Liverpool, they're still working and they'll go forever. When I left, they were buying in Tuppenny Halfpenny clock movements from Europe and sticking them on the back of a dial, and those clocks will last for probably maybe a couple of years. If you're lucky, we took them away and getting a new one. So for me, there's a big issue there about sustainability and using up the world's resources. So I've got quite a lot of experience working in engineering. But the Metro Mayor is a completely new role. And what the role is going to be is coordinating not just the three authorities of Bristol, Bath and North East Somerset and South Gloss, but also North Somerset. Although they didn't elect to be part of this devolution deal, they will still be part of it in terms of certainly the joint spatial plan and the joint transport plan. And there will be other areas as well, like the LEP, because the North Somerset are also involved in the LEP. So there will still be a link, and maybe after 4 years, North Somerset will decide it wants to play a fuller part and join up with us. You've heard the four key areas, which is housing and transport, and those two are the ones that most concern people across the west of England. The other two are skills training and the economy. Obviously, there's a very clear link there because we know there are big skill gaps in this area, particularly in high-tech industries, also in construction. So we need housing. We haven't got the people to build them. We haven't got the people, the plumbers, the carpenters, etc., etc. As part of this campaign, I met a woman whose daughter is on a course to get her into engineering. I think that's absolutely fantastic. She's one of two. I've got a friend who's an engineer, Amanda her name is, and she's left engineering because she got so sick of the harassment that she received. And that was in a big organisation. And that was when we had the laws to protect her at work. And when I look at your manifesto, which I think is really, really interesting, number four is about diversity, and that's one of my fortes. You've got it down number four, it really ought to be number one. Because what we're doing is we're missing out on a lot of talent across the west of England. As I say, I work in the health service, and there was a report a few years ago called Snowy White Peaks by Roger Klein. And if you look at that, he says basically the whole of the NHS is a snowy white peak. There are very few black and minority ethnic people in senior roles. That's the same in my trust, it's the same in John's trust. It's not just specific to one organisation. But somehow we've not managed to encourage and infuse and support people in career development within our organisation. It's something I've been working on at South Mead Hospital and something that we've been doing very well on, the Workforce Race Equality Standard. We had four key indicators that were analysed by the NHS, and our trust came out top, not just in the region, but in the country. I'm very proud of that.
But we've
still got a long way to go. So for diversity, if we're going to get anywhere, we've got to start picking up on these skills that we're losing. Again, in the hospital, we have cleaners and porters who are black. They've come from overseas, not all of them, but some of them. Many of them are actually doing degrees at the same time. At the moment, they're filling a very needed position in the hospital. We need the cleaners and the porters. We can't operate without them. But those people find it a real struggle to get a job afterwards. So for me, as Metro Mayor, I'm more than happy to support all of your 10 demands. I want to make that equality one the main one, because I do think we're missing out. And in a way, we've got to deal with the discrimination. So it's great to be here today. It's wonderful to see all you women here as well. So, and I'm happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to remind you, audience, that as soon as these are finished, we're going to go over to you. So start thinking about your questions and what you want to push people on. And I think, just to stand up, this isn't weighted in numbers 1 to 10 of importance. So I think for me, inclusion, one of the things that's great about this is inclusion is written throughout as something that's really key to our sector. Stephen, as you're late, are you okay? You're ready?
Yeah.
Great, then let's hear from you. And I will honk you if you're over 5 minutes.
Fine. Give me 1 minute warning as well.
I will.
Well, first of all, sorry for being, I think, the last candidate to arrive. I think I'll describe it as rather than being late. I live in St Andrews, so I got the train from Montpellier, which should have got me here at 29 minutes past 8, which would have been perfect. But as sometimes happens in local public transport, things work according to plan. All the more reason to read the transport section of my manifesto. It has some really ambitious plans for how we can make our buses work and our train network work in the way that it does in so many other cities. And that's one of the challenges about this role, that this region, which we have lots of reasons to be very proud of, we are the most prosperous dual city region outside London, but actually there are lots of things we don't get right. Public transport is certainly one of them. One of the things we don't get right is shouting loud enough about what we're good at. And what you do is very good, and it's leading in the country, but having spent a large chunk of my political lifetime at the other end of the railway line in London, I can say, and it disappoints me to say, that policymakers in London don't appreciate that, often don't know it. When you tell them about it, they raise their eyebrows and they're questioning about whether Bristol and Bath really can be world-leading in anything, because surely it's London, surely it's Silicon Roundabout, surely it's Shoreditch, surely it's all the hipsters in East London rather than Bristol or Bath. And if it's not, surely it must be Oxford or Cambridge. And that's a big challenge for our region, to be proud of what we do, not just internally, and know that the biggest cluster of sort of silicon-based industries outside Palo Alto is here. It's not anywhere else in Europe. It's not anywhere else in the UK. But when I was telling, when I was a minister in the coalition government, when I was saying this to George Osborne and to my own colleague, Vince Cable, they were very sceptical about whether that was actually true, and were much more keen to shout about how London is a global city and is leading the way in the sort of industries of the future. So what you need and what the region needs is a regional mayor, a so-called metro mayor, who is going to understand and have deep knowledge about what are the strengths of this region, what holds us back from being even stronger, but is able to communicate our strengths, certainly back to Westminster and Whitehall and to the rest of the world as well. And the rest of the world, of course, is going to become even more important to us as we are now embarking on what I think is going to be a very painful journey to April 2019, when it now looks as though we will be exiting from the European Union, which I think is a fundamental mistake. I still oppose it. I still hope in some way that can be averted, or at least, at the very least, ameliorated. And working across national boundaries and ethnic boundaries is incredibly important to our industry. I agree with what Leslie said about diversity. I don't particularly worry about what order it is in your manifesto, but diversity is a great strength, and all successful businesses recognise that if you're going to succeed, you need to tap the talents of every single community in a city region. And there's plenty of studies to show that businesses that do reach out to black and minority ethnic communities or embrace gender and sexuality as well are the most successful. Now, in terms of this sector, I read your manifesto early this morning, and the first thing he says is to engage with and to be an advocate for the community.
Well, 1 minute, Stephen.
I've done that over a long period of time, and in the course of this election, I have met both with Creative Bath and with Bristol Media as well to update my understanding of what the needs of the sector are. And in my manifesto, as well as reading the transport section, and my manifesto is available online at my website, I hope you'll find lots of things that were informed by the comments that I received. In particular, using part of the economic development fund that the regional mayor is going to get, that £120 million for the 4 years, to invest in affordable space so that businesses which are moving on from the next stage of being a one-person or a two-person business but then need extra physical space are able to hire it so they are not held back. And there are plenty of other areas in your manifesto that I entirely embrace as well. I'm curious to know what the advantages
minutes,
are from big data, and maybe that will come up in questions. Thank you.
Thank you. I finally meet him.
Thank you very much. Please excuse me for standing. As we said at the start, in my industry, I spend a lot of time looking at sitting on stools, and I find them particularly uncomfortable. So if somebody can design the comfortable stool, I'd be very grateful. I've got a very good big market for it. Thanks very much. I think it's a great opportunity for us to meet lots of people in this particular election, in lots of different sectors. It's really exciting to be able to talk to you today. I think for a number of reasons, and I'm going to try and focus on what the Mayor's role is about, and therefore how we can work together. Because I think it's been laid out earlier that it's very much going to be a collaborative role. It's going to be somebody who chairs and works with the leaders of the councils, works with the business leaders, and helps us deliver for the future. I think the key here is the future, and that's really where I think this is exciting talking to everybody here. We're talking very much about the creative sector, but I think we also need to look beyond that about how we then take those creative and innovative ideas as the mayor and then bring them both to fruition, but use them then as part of the economic growth, which is how the government will judge the success of this role. So I think we've got to do a number of things as a mayor. We've got to be somebody who can champion, somebody who can understand, who can work with and collaborate, who can excite the existing councils. And let's face it, councils don't always think about creative technology when it comes to helping develop businesses. We try to think that way at South Gloucestershire, where I'm involved, and I was in a meeting yesterday where we were talking about the future, where we were talking about how we can help support both the creative sector, but also, more importantly, how we can apply it ourselves as a council. I think that's going to be one of the keys here, is driving it with the council leaders about how we take, support and deliver the creative ideas that everybody in this room and in the industry can provide. We've heard before, we are in one of the most successful regions in the country. We've got a long history of success. We have got a long and proud history of innovation. We were talking recently about referring to it, the area as the home of the aerospace industry. That's really innovation-led. So yes, we can look at applications to help support our big businesses. But also, the things that everybody in this room is working on are invariably starting at small business levels. That's something we should be very, very conscious of and be supporting as well as a mayor. We need to provide the support that you've outlined in here in terms of not just funding. We can help with that in terms of the funding that we will get as a mayor. And I think that's important. We need to be going out and taking the message about developing those skills, exciting people at early ages about not just the fact that this is creative, but what it delivers, how getting involved. We go out and excite our children at schools at the moment. They will be coming through as people who are motivated and want to be driven by providing not just the technology and supporting you, but helping it deliver into everyday lives. The role of the mayor will involve transport, it will involve housing, it will involve business and skills. We as mayors have to champion every one of those and drive through into each of those sectors what you're all working on. We've got really, really exciting, really dynamic creative hubs. We need to invest in those. We need to go out and tell that story globally. And that's the sort of thing that a proactive mayor can do. And that's really what I think is the thing that we can bring to this, is to working in collaboration. I know that's a key to one of the things you talked about. Collaboration, support, and helping deliver the innovative ideas that everybody here is coming up with, and taking those out there, delivering them throughout the region. We've got to bear in mind it is a whole region.
We're not
just talking about the hubs and the city centres. If we're getting our infrastructure right, if we're getting the next generations and the ambition of how we're delivering that infrastructure, we can then support the creative technologies throughout the whole region. So that's really how I want to look at things, is how we develop throughout the whole region, how we work with you to support, develop, motivate the future employees and people in the region, and how we can drive that through to help the economic growth.
Great, thank you very much. say thanks. I think we heard quite a lot about how great we are as a sector. I think we know that. That's great. We heard a bit about profile. We've got it. We haven't got it. We don't shout out loud enough. Maybe we'll get back to that. And we had varying levels of detail around the brief that the speakers were asked to respond to. So please feel free to push them on your pet areas of the manifesto. But I'm going to start by asking you for some detail around the LEP question. So I think that our LEP is pretty well respected around the country, and it's done a pretty great job because it's been properly business-led. And so it's spoken meaningfully to industry. And I think there is a danger that these changes will kind of add bureaucracy and levels of administration and kind of remove some of that industry leadership. So I'd like you all to kind of speak about how you'll ensure that our sectors are kind of continue to be represented and driving the LEP. And any of you can go in first. John, please.
Well, yes, I think you're right. The LEP has done very well, but don't have any doubt about it. The business leadership has had to struggle against quite marked intransigence from the local authorities. The idea of the LEP was that they would be business-led, and they gradually tried to morph that into being just an extension of local authorities. The LEP is a really important function, and I see it, whatever the arrangements have been prepared in advance, I see it as being an essential part of what must be, will have to be, quite a small piece of additional bureaucracy. I don't think we need to add loads and loads of people. The job is about communication out to the outside world, particularly with Whitehall and Westminster, and with those people that we want to continue to see us as our friends, whether we're directly engaged in Europe or whether on the outside. So the LEP is important. It's done a great job. Some of my friends have led it, but it has been undermined by that sort of complacency that you so often find in, I'm afraid, local government. Politicians will do the same things. They've had 30 years. Well, I've done 30 years. They have not delivered. And we have to make sure that we deliver on this. And be warned, the promise of 30 years of 30 million is a lie. No government in this country, no Treasury, has the power to commit that far forward. So part of this job will have to be fighting to keep the independence that will just have been hard won. Nobody can promise on that far with government money, but we need to make sure this concept of devolution is maintained and grows, and that we have more of a say about what we're doing about our own patch.
Great, thank you.
Thank you. Yes, with regard to the LEP, what concerns me is it tends to be focused on big business, and we know that the largest number of businesses are actually small businesses.
I think the Creative LEP is pretty good at SMEs, actually, to be honest.
Okay. But at the end of the day, this role is going to be about bringing different people together. And part of your manifesto talks about partnership and collaboration. And for me, that's really crucial. I've worked in different organisations with different people for a long time. And part of my skills is working with people from all parts of those organisations, whoever they are. And that's really important for the LEP as well. It's not about focusing on just one sector. It's about ensuring that we involve all sectors. We've been told for a long time that what really keeps the country going is the invisible industries, the banks and insurance. Well, we've seen those at the moment stating quite clearly they're going to clear off to Europe because it's not going to happen now. We've got Brexit. And that's a real concern. I think that's one of the reasons that we've got this snap election coming up, because things are not working the way they should be. And if we're going to make this work in the west of England, then we've got to start looking at how we get not just the funding that it's been given, but more funding as well. Because certainly on the transport section, they've not given us enough. But at the end of the day, we were asked last night if we thought that the salary for the Metro Mayor will be worth it. Well, it will, providing the Metro Mayor is able to bring more funding in. And that's what a lot of this is going to be about. But I say it's got to be about a mixed economy. It's got to be mixed businesses. And going back to the cultural aspect, I mean, Bristol is just fantastic. Well, the west of England is, in terms of the culture, the arts, the music. We all know Aardman and Massive Attack and so on and so forth. We've got to We've got to build on those as well. We can't leave anything.
If we stay on the left for now, we're going to come back to culture for sure. Darren?
I might take a slightly more challenging approach to this.
Great.
And maybe leave you with a couple of questions. So, my last job when I was in the civil service, on behalf of regional government, before they stripped it away, was to read all 43 of the local enterprise partnerships' initial strategies. So all of the LEPs across the country had to put in a strategy. Now, bluntly, and I haven't made too many friends by saying this, but I'm going to go with it, is that you only need to read three. Cornwall's, Liverpool's, and any one of the others. Because the other 41 basically said exactly the same thing. Everyone is saying, we want to lead in the creative digital tech sector. We want to have a vibrant tourism economy. We want to have a blah, 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 blah. Now, the difference with Liverpool and Cornwall's was they had a real sense of identity. Cornwall, they just want to be Cornwall. Liverpool have really captured a sense of what Liverpool's about as distinct from the other core cities in the UK. So my challenge to the LEP and to this, because you have that creativity, it's at the heart of what you do, is to say, how are you going to sell the uniqueness of this cluster at a level which grabs global attention?
How are you going to sell this cluster?
Well, of course, what I'm saying from a green perspective is that the next generation of business is about the circular economy. It's about genuine sustainability. Now, I'll read something in here, just my other challenge. In here it says, number 8, enables the development of technological solutions to the region's problems. Now, if you ask anybody outside on the street and say, what are the region's problems? They'll say housing and transport. They won't say an app to get the best coffee in Bristol, right? So that's my other challenge. If you're genuinely about solving the problems, how is it the LEP is going to leverage all of that skill and talent that we spent ages talking about and turn it into real stuff? Now, 30 million quid is not a great deal of money, but it's a start. The really interesting thing about the next couple of years is for this LEP to prove that it can use that innovation quickly and efficiently to start to change things. If you do that, more money will be thrown your way to say, yes, do more, innovate, experiment, prove to government that you can do things differently. And I believe that more money will flow.
Thank you. Stephen or Tim?
Well, I supported the creation of the LEP, I think it was back in 2011, by the coalition government. One of the reasons why I was keen to see that happen was because I had bad memories of the South West Regional Development Agency, which was a remote, opaque institution. I think in my first 5 years as an MP, granted me an audience on one occasion to talk about Bristol, but it had an impossible remit all the way from the Scilly Islands up to the Cotswolds and down to Bournemouth. So the coalition created 39, I think it was, LEPs that are much more tightly focused on natural, if that's the right word, economic areas. And the Bristol and Bath, west of England area, obviously, is one of them. Like Darren, I also had the, I'm not sure whether it was the pleasure, but certainly it's part of my work as a minister in the Department of Communities and Local Governments to read many of the strategic economic plans from those LEPs, because the Cabinet Committee I was a member of appraised them all and made the grant allocations as a result of them. And he's right, actually. Everyone wants to be a leader in this sector. Lots of coastal places want to be the leader in boat building, in chandlery, and everything else as well. And that was one of the things that made us sceptical about how genuine some of the pitches were. But as I said in my introductory remarks, this area does have a good story to tell, and we have to be better at telling it. I've always worked closely with the business community, in particular in Bristol. Prior to being an MP in 2005, I worked for 17 years in the private sector as a tax and business consultant with PwC and Grant Thornton, so I actually met an awful lot of startup entrepreneurs who were setting up their own businesses at that time. And when the LEP was created, it was a good change from this word. I was able to meet Colin Skelletts, who was a great chair, I think, of the LEP for the last 6 years or so, on a regular basis, both here and in London, so that we could swap notes about what we needed to do. And if I'm elected to this post, I will certainly continue that incredibly close collaboration with with Stephen Robson, the new LEP chair, and with all the other members of the board, and indeed I've been meeting some of them in the course of this election. I think if this job is going to be successful and is going to make a difference, it has to work completely in harmony with the business community so that we can grow our already successful economy. But the political point is we must make sure that that prosperity reaches every community and everyone has an opportunity to share in the success.
Thank you. Tim.
Thanks. The LEP is good. The LEP is the right way we should be looking at how we're going to collaborate and work with business. It needs to be the starting point. It needs to be, I'm not going to say it's part of a pyramid, but it needs to be at the lead in terms of how we're working with business. We have said all along that the way this role will be judged is its success in economic growth. Councils cannot drive that. Councils are a very important part of it because they are managing the whole area in lots of different ways. The way we drive business growth will be working with the business community. The LEP is the starting point with that and has to be the key focus. We need to then work within the LEP in terms of how we then address new sectors, bringing new sectors into the LEP, influencing the thinking with the LEP, but ultimately that's the right point at which this should work. We've touched on small business, startup business, vital in lots of sectors, particularly here. So we've got to make sure we're getting that right focus. That is something actually councils can help with. But again, it's far better that those decisions are being made by the business community and we can drive that through the LEP as a result. So the mayor needs to be somebody who understands business, who's got a track record in working in business, in promoting business. I'm not going to go long and hard on my pitch for that as the mayor, but yes, that's what I've been doing in my professional life for the last 30 years. So we've got to get that combination, we've got to drive that through the business community. The LEP needs to be innovative, it needs to be able to be flexible, and it needs to be able to grow with the region as we develop.
Great. Thank you. Audience, it's your turn. Yes, straight away.
My name's Chris Lelling, and I'm chair of Bristol Media, which, if you don't know, is a membership organisation in the region which has 600 paying members in the creative sector from large organisations like Arden down to lots of freelancers. I'd just like to push the candidates a bit more on the specifics, because I think I've heard quite a lot of sort of generalities around promoting the region or good sorts of things that probably everyone would say. So just to pick up one particular area that is of growing concern to me is around our property portfolio for growing creative businesses in Bristol and Bath. I help a number of businesses who are finding it a huge challenge to get their next move, they're looking to grow. But there really is a dearth of the kind of properties that would be suitable for them. And I think more generally, you just have a complete disconnect between the kind of property economy we've got and what creative businesses need, which is more flexibility, the ability to kind of scale up, scale down, and a property sector that doesn't really work like that. So I'd really be interested in more sort of specific proposals for how we can create a better property office environment for creative
offices. Chris has just asked the candidates for their specific proposals around property and creative businesses that need grow on space, that need more flexibility. It's a key issue in our sector.
Let's go to this side. Tim, do you want to start as you've got the last?
This might sound cheesy, it's not meant to be. It needs to be a sensible conversation, because that conversation and that feedback needs to come through to the mayor. The mayor, as we said before, is going to sit with the councils, therefore we need to be getting that information back to him. We've got to be thinking, I mean, the whole point about this mayor is somebody who's got to have ambition and look forward for the future. So we need to be taking that feedback from you. We then need to be driving that through both the councils, because councils do have a role in that, in terms of some of the property portfolios they hold, but also in terms of how they look at how development is made. We need to, in terms of delivering our housing shortage, we need to look at innovative ideas there. there are ways in which I can see at the moment in current developments where developers are looking at adding in business units specific to where those developments are in terms of how they relate to their local workplaces. So we need to have that coming in. It needs to be fed through. The mayor can drive that, and that can be done through the councils. So in terms of that chain, it will work if we have that direct conversation. That's why I think the mayor is good for you, because it's somebody you can come and speak to who is responsible and is accountable and is that face. I'm sure at the moment the problem you've got is actually where do you go to say that? That's great. Come to me, come to the mayor, they can take that on board, then we can work out we're going to deliver it for you.
Great. Thank you. Yep, go Steve.
I've urged you all earlier to have a look at my manifesto while we've been sitting here. I've tweeted it with a picture of you all as well, so with the link, so please do have a look. In the economy section, after the overview, I've got some sort of sectoral points to make. And in the section of creative and digital entertaining and informing the world, I say, I will promote the growth of creative companies in the Temple Meads Enterprise Zone. I will use part of the four-year $120 million local growth pot to invest in premises for business startups in the creative sector, and will also identify via the Public Property Board any state-owned premises that could be better used by new businesses. So hopefully, because that directly answers the point that you make, and it's a point that many small businesses have made to me over the years, it's getting to that next step of often starting at home, in particular in this industry that is heavily populated by micro businesses as opposed to small businesses. How do you progress to that next step when you need to invest in physical space? One of the downsides of being a prosperous and successful regional economy is that rentals are very high, and that can be a real barrier to taking that next step and getting the space literally to grow your business. So hopefully that is one of the solutions. And incidentally, it's a similar problem for social enterprises as well, another sector I've identified in my manifesto, something that Bristol is incredibly good at finding sort of innovative solutions to deliver public services in a more holistic way via social enterprises. And there's lots of good providers of social enterprise space in Bristol, but they are physically running out of affordable space as well. And I know one of the things that was in the SEP put forward by the LEP a couple of years ago was to address that problem right here in Temple Meads with Home for Social Enterprise. And I think that will build a good sort of ecosystem, economic ecosystem, in the Temple Meads Enterprise Zone. If we have more creative and digital businesses, we've got the university moving into that dreadful Royal Mail building over the next few years, if we can have social enterprise as well, I think we'll have a great sort of economic ecosystem right where we're sitting at the moment.
Thank you, Leslie.
Thank you. I also have a manifesto. You'll find this online on the manifesto.
I'm sure you've all got manifestos. Yeah,
so go have a look at that. You'll find there's quite a lot of things in there about businesses, and especially small businesses. As we know, this area is a whole regeneration area. Where I am in Radstock, I was part of the Radstock and Westfield Economic Partnership set up a few years ago by Baines Council. And the exact same thing came out of there, that it's okay when businesses are starting up, but where do they go when they're growing? In Radstock and Westfield, not many places. The government have said that they are going to set up what they're calling the Soma Valley Enterprise Zone, which is part of the same area. So that will be an opportunity to make sure we get the sort of things that you need to move into. In Froome, just over the border from us, they refitted a whole building, an old building that was no longer in use for industry, and they found that they filled it very quickly with people that wanted to move on. And there's buildings not far from here, just at the back there of the engine shed, back at Temple Meads, where again they're standing completely empty. So, you know, here's an opportunity to use the money coming through the Metro Mayor and the devolution deal to refit those buildings. I do worry a bit when we keep knocking these places down and rebuilding with these things that you sort of clip together. You know, why not refit a solid building and make it do what you need it to do? So, again, the consultation that you've asked for to make sure it fits your need. And another thing that's in my manifesto is broadband. where I live, and this can be in cities as well as in rural areas, I can turn my computer on, go make a cup of tea, come back and it's still thinking about it. It's hopeless if you are trying to run a business. So bringing in faster broadband is absolutely crucial. So that's not just in rural areas, that's in cities as well.
We're going to come, we've just had a question on Twitter about broadband, so we're going to come back to that. Let's hear from John and Darren about property.
Okay, so I don't know whether I've got a website or whatever, manifesto. Look, there's a serious danger about turning everything into tactics. Even though I find it a bit deceitful, the idea that this is 30 years of 30 million is about strategy. And we have to think strategically. And you and I have got to have the confidence to do that. Work and where you live and where you go to play are key parts, the parts of our lives. The problem with property, whether it's business property or homes, is supply and demand. We have steadfastly failed to build enough property of any kind over the last 40 years. A real insistence by local government not to raise to it. So let's just take houses. I'll come back to your point. I think the proposition of 100 odd thousand houses, when we wrote the book about the vision for Greater Bristol 2050, called High in Hope, we pointed to the need for 300,000 houses by 2050. That's the real number that is needed. And you can't think about building houses on their own. That is exactly what's going on now. There's a massive infill. They build houses. They don't build workplaces. They don't build extra doctor surgeries. We don't train the doctors to come into those surgeries. We don't build libraries and so on. We have to build places in which there are the appropriate means of housing workplaces close to where people live. And of course, there's the inevitable need to have efficient connectivity between where you work. It could be walking, but you may need to go a longer distance for meeting your clients. Where you work, to where you live, to where you play. But it's a strategic thing, and it won't change overnight. We need to take 7,000 hectares of land to satisfy the need for those 300,000 houses and all of the associated provision. Places to work, places to play, and so on. 7,000 hectares of land has got to be found. And of course, local government will throw their hands up in horror because they'll be frightened that some of that land is next door to one of their voters. We've got to face up to it, folks. This is an expansion area, and we've got to make sure it does expand and that our economy gets better. But we can't do it without understanding the need to build.
Great.
So there is a strategic point, but I'm also going to come back and try and deal with some of the specifics, because one of the reasons, someone said to me when I arrived back in Bristol, one of the reasons why Bristol is so good is that it succeeds despite the system, not because of it. And because it's got this really vibrant grassroots attitude of kind of creativity and innovation. And that happens sometimes in the best places where it happens is where it's in disused, unused, kind of unsupported places in the city. Now, I was with the Hannam Greenbelt group recently, where they were saying, look, proposals, I've got to say, about building all these houses and all these workspaces and all this green space, they obviously don't want. But they took me to a site near Hannam, not far, a couple of miles away, right next to all the shops that are struggling, in a 5.75 disused retail space, 5.75 acres. Can you imagine how much workspace you can get onto 5.75 acres of disuse? The warehouses are already there. I mean, you can either flatten them or do something interesting with them. But unless we get much, much more proactive about all of that space that's just being land banked and sat on at the moment, we're not going to free up the system. So that's one. Of course, remote working and flexible working from home is part of the solution, because people are just they are working more flexibly. They're not doing 9-to-5 in offices anymore. They're coming into the city to co-working spaces, to coffee shops, to meeting places, because they'd like to be able to work flexibly from home. So I think that's part of the solution. But the challenge, the strategic challenge, which I'd like to throw up as an interesting conversation, is right now there's a conversation about doubling the size of Cabot retail area and Cribbs Causeway. At the same time, as most other people are talking about not going shopping anymore.
Is this strictly on topic, though?
Yes, it is, because we've got... Why are we not talking about the future of the economy that looks at the kind of jobs that we need over the next 20 years. If we were going to double the accommodation in those areas, we shouldn't be doubling the amount of shopping that's going on. We should be doubling the amount of creative workshop space. We've got high streets where we're just filling them with charity shops because that's the easy thing to do at the moment. If we went and looked at Bedminster High Street or some of these other high streets that are struggling and said, let's fill it with creative workspaces instead and think about the difference in our communities and societies, I think we'd come up with some pretty quick wins about where we could do some really interesting work.
Right, I'm going to take a question from Twitter, then we're going to go to the back, but there's quite a lot to get through, so I'm going to urge you to stay on topic and to be precise in your questions. So the first question that I'm going to take from the live stream, which is all I understand now working, is from Tom Oliver, who says, the region is reliant on networked indie design professionals using poor rural broadband. The government is failing to deliver. What will the candidates do? So we want specifics. Darren, we'll start with you.
Okay, well, beware politicians making promises that they can't see through. I think the reality of this is about lobbying government to say that we need regulation on it, because as far as I can make out, there are very few incentives for the businesses to really go above and beyond to connect up really fast broadband into remote areas where they know there's very little profit involved. In which case, if we're going to be serious about this, this is about either pushing it through regulation of that industry or putting in infrastructure money that says we're going to put in hubs out in our rural areas so that people aren't commuting into Bristol, congestion, all that sort of stuff. We're going to have a hub in Thornbury, we're going to have one in Wootton, we're going to have one in Yates, we're going to have one in Cleve, we're going to have one, etc., etc.
Thank you. John.
Well, of course, it's an essential part of modern life. I mean, oddly, there are places in the country, I happen to have just moved into one, fairly remote, fantastic broadband. So it's a question of how fast the whole system is being upgraded. It isn't going fast enough. Commercial influence has to affect this. People have to get a return for their money. You know, without business, there's nothing. You're involved in business. But I do think there's a role for this job to put greater pressure on speeding it up, because it's like blood, isn't it? We just have to have good communications.
Great, thank you. Leslie?
I've already spoken about the commitment to faster broadband in my manifesto. And what I will do specifically is, Bath and North East Somerset Council have promised broadband for I don't know how long. We've heard a lot of talk about strategy and action plans and inequality work. That's what you hear all the time. What you don't see is anything actually happening. And my role and the work that I'm successful at is looking for solutions and making it happen. And that's what I will do.
Thanks.
Well, thanks to Tom for the question. In the manifesto you presented to us, I think you referred to this as broadband as the fourth utility. And it does require a step change in policymakers' mindsets to appreciate that having access to the internet ought to be seen as a right for every citizen, and for every business to grow, you need the best possible access to the internet. I first heard a variant on that phrase, a fourth utility, 10 years ago, not here in Britain, but in Tallinn, from Anders Inskip, who was the Liberal Prime Minister of Estonia at that time, who recognised that if a small country is going to compete against enormous neighbours or with fellow Nordic entrepreneurs, that it needed to be at the cutting edge of technology. And Estonia has led the way across the European Union in terms of its investment in Wi-Fi and broadband, and lots of tech industries have sprung up in Tallinn as a result, and NATO's internet weaponry that we get from Russia, as we know, in the American election, hopefully we won't get it here, is based in Tallinn, partly for that reason, because they've got the infrastructure. We've not developed as well as a small country as Estonia, so it does need that step change in politicians' minds. And the only way we can do that locally is by putting pressure on DCMS, the department that leads this, is to not only get it right in central Bristol and central Bath, where, let's face it, the connections are pretty good, but to make sure that people in Hawkesbury, Upton, and Tewmagna Radstock and elsewhere are able to get access to, because innovation and creativity isn't just in our cities. A lot of people, obviously in the rural communities of the west of England, will be doing it too. So it is a priority.
Thank you. Tim?
I see broadband as the most important infrastructure element that the mayor can be involved with. I see transport and aspects like that in terms of, some people see that as infrastructure. I'm separating this out. I see broadband as the key to the infrastructure. We've talked about future prosperity, economic growth. It is vital. Yes, we are failing in our rural areas. My family home is in Somerset. In Somerset, we've got an innovative individual in the village who now runs his own village network that works incredibly successfully. So we've got to think differently. We've got to get away from the reliance on what is effectively the two main providers. We need to make sure we're providing new ideas and new solutions. The mayor can help drive that, but he's got to be able to go and knock some heads together, because at the moment the big two providers are not delivering. So that's how I think I can make a difference, is by bringing in innovation and actually going and making a difference with the big providers.
Great, thank you. Do we have an audience mic, Nick, or are we just... that's right, if you say... We'll go here and I'll shout it back to the stream.
My question is specifically around developing post-exceed skills, OK? Now, I've got two questions. What will your role be involved in this, and what's your vision for the future? Now, I believe that Bristol and the surrounding area has a fantastic creative, digital, high-tech industry. And from a personal perspective, I've got two young children about to start secondary school. The wealth of opportunities in these sectors are not being communicated to young people so that they can develop the relevant skills that they need to go into these sectors. Now, I work in post-16 skills at the moment, and I've visited a number of schools in the Bristol, Bath, North Somerset regions, and the difference in the offering to young people is just alarming. Some schools give them fantastic opportunities, they have fantastic ways in which they can develop these skills. Other schools don't offer those same opportunities. So it's a lottery as to where you are lucky enough to send your children to at the moment. And I would like to see all schools in the region being offered the same opportunities in terms of developing their young people's skills. So my question is, how will you help in this role?
So for the benefit of the stream, who might not have heard that question, the question is, what's your vision for the future of post-16 skills? What are you personally going to do, and how do we address the postcode lottery of quality provision across the region? And we'll start with Leslie.
Thank you. Another part of my manifesto is about the transport section, and that is about providing free bus passes for young people that are in education, and that is absolutely crucial. If you're living in a rural area, it can be really difficult to get to a college. We're getting fewer colleges, and as you've rightly pointed out, the quality is different. It's really important that we've got access to education in the first place, and part of the remit for the Metro Mayor is about skills development, but for people who are furthest from the job market and also people who are disabled. If you look at what's happened with education over the past 20, 30 years or more, we've seen basic skills training has gone. What we need in the health service is people that can pass that level one English and maths to even get into work. And we actually do a lot of training on that. And we're using the apprenticeship levy, we will be, to deliver that within the hospital. Obviously, we're a big employer, but that needs to be rolled out elsewhere. There's a whole number of things that we need to be looking at to support people. I was talking to one organisation, an advice centre, that provides support for people to get them into jobs, and they can't read and write. But that advice centre is losing its funding and will probably close. So unless we've got those basic skills sorted out, we are really going to struggle, as well as making sure that the education we've got is quality. And again, what the Metro Mayor will need to be doing is working with the three local authorities, because they have the responsibility for local education. Where the schools have gone into academies, we need to look at the quality of that as well. £140 million has been wasted on setting up schools and other organisations, training organisations that have failed, they've closed early. And hopefully this general election that's coming up, we are going to see a change in government and we'll see a change in policy in the way we work as outlined in the Labour Party manifesto and as in their pledges and in my manifesto.
Okay, I'm going to... Can I just reiterate? We are talking about post-16 skills, not education, which does come into the remit of the Metro Mayor. Okay, we've got it. Please stay on point, candidates. We've got loads of questions to get through. John?
The answer of what the mayor can do is make a noise, and make a big noise. Whatever other challenges we have, transport, broadband, whatever, the thing that we should concentrate on is our young. And unfortunately, post-16 doesn't start at 16. It starts at 4. And we have to make a big noise, there's no question. We abandon about 20% of our young. So if you're lucky enough to have a good family, you're nurtured, you're pushed, and you go to a decent school, you've got a chance. But what are we up against? We're up against a curriculum that is still driven by 19th century values and doesn't understand how to unleash interest in young people. They're not all the same. They need nurturing. And we're up against the fact that the local authorities don't run the schools, do they? There are now so many independent schools, they set off on their own, their qualities are not maintained across an even set of standards, even with Ofsted. So there's a big noise to be made. I'm chairing another organisation which offers completely alternative approaches to young people. But post-16 doesn't start at 16, it starts at 4. And we've got to connect those things up.
Thank you. Stephen, you've got the mic over there, do you want to...
post-19 adult education does become a responsibility of the Metro Mayor from next year. So there will be an opportunity to shape the offer that further education colleges put forward and also apprenticeship programmes as well. I've said in my manifesto I want to make sure that what the colleges are delivering is aligned to the growth prospects of our economy. Most of them are fairly good at that already. An example would be completely different to what we're talking about here. Hospitality and tourism, incredibly important to both cities' economy, not identified, incidentally, in the strategic economic plan of the left, which I think is a mistake, but Bath College is making a major investment at the moment in making sure that the offer in that area aligns with the opportunities that are forthcoming. And I've said in my manifesto I'll appoint an apprenticeship champion for each of the sectors to make sure that there are articulate young people who can go into schools and colleges and tell young people how they're succeeding and how they're having lucrative and rewarding careers by following that skilled path rather than, and I agree with John about this, what quite often, I'm not going to annoy any school teachers who might be in the room or listening to this, what quite often still happens in schools is that teachers and head teachers will set children down an academic path predicated on getting those benchmark 5 GCSEs, including maths and English, getting A-levels and getting into university, because that's what schools feel that they are measured against, and that's what teachers are comfortable with articulating to their pupils. So you do have to start a lot younger in the schools. John is quite right about that. I don't know whether it's 4, but certainly by the time a child gets to year 6, you do need to place in front of that class an engineer saying this is a career for you, and in particular it's a career for women, because 95% of engineering apprentices are men. So there's huge gender imbalances that we have to deal with right across the skilled sector as well. And that's something I've talked about for most of my time in politics. And there is a social equality issue as well. That, as you say, some schools do this well. They explain the full range of opportunities that are available to people, some don't. And that is something that politicians can do something about by visiting schools and colleges and talking about themselves. But what I will specifically want to do, if I'm a regional mayor, is identifying that persuasive cohort of younger people. I'm 50, you know, so I'm not the best person to motivate a 10-year-old, frankly. But to find the young people who they can relate to go into schools and enthuse them about the opportunities that are available to them.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'll stand over here
a
little bit so I can talk to you. 19 plus education comes in year 2. That is going to be direct remit. what I think is going to be important for us to actually work on now is the skills aspect. The way we will do this, to answer your question, is by going and talking to children at a young age and showing them what it means. If we talk about sectors, if we talk about types of jobs, I don't believe people get that. If you go and show them what it means, let's face it, lots of people will tell you how if they have a problem at home with technology, they go and ask their youngest because they know how to fix it. They know how it works. Those are the people we need to be going and talking to and exciting about all our career opportunities in the region, and there's more than just creative. But that is the answer. The mayor can champion that. The mayor can work with business and do it. And I believe if you go and take, and let's take, I won't pick out an individual company, but we've got so many different people who are doing really clever jobs in the creative sector. Take them and introduce them to somebody at a young age, excite them, show them what it means in real terms, then we'll get people really pouring into the industry. I think it's that simple.
Great, thank you. Darren?
Okay, so you phrased it in two aspects, the role of the mayor and the vision of the mayor. So if I do the vision bit first, there's a slight rub here in that recent report showed that one in four jobs in the UK is at risk due to automation. One in four. That's a huge impact. Now, I don't think government and I don't think the system is thinking about that implication enough, and it's certainly not kind of rattling through the system into schools. So the vision, from my point of view, is about the leadership role of the West of England Combined Authority and the LEP to say, what is the future of work? Because businesses are going to need to lead this agenda of saying, the future of work is X, therefore we need to be investing in people to create the flow of employees for the future of work. Now, we've ended up with a complete lottery in the school system where, ironically, we kind of do programs in schools in the worst areas, which are about retail, and we made a slight disparaging remark about hairdressing earlier on. Whereas the good schools, we've got lots of people going in and talking about Thrust SSC and Silicon and all this sort of stuff. Now in the middle, I've participated in some really good programs where forward-thinking businesses and some really good social enterprise charitable organizations are taking business people into schools and saying this is about the future of work. So I would see my role as twofold. One is championing this thought process about the future of work, and then making sure we prioritise business partnerships between forward-thinking businesses who've got the capacity and the foresight to go into those schools that are struggling and inspire those children. And I agree with John from way before 16 to say this is it. As we do that, I think teachers will then latch on to those partnerships and start to try to find space to excite the children in those processes.
Thank you. Right, who has questions that haven't been answered? Because I'm going to take both of you there. And then we're going to hear from... So we've got 10 minutes left.
Mike Barley, I chair the High Tech Sector Group for the Local Enterprise Partnership. I agree with the previous question, supply side is probably the biggest challenge to a local high-tech sector group. But I'll switch my question to demand side, and how would you attract companies to the area, investors to the area, into the high-tech sector group or the creative sector?
Great, that's good. And then, Paul, did you have one too?
Yeah, my question is a very short one.
Please, I'm
going to
run around.
Okay, thanks. Keep going. I'm Paul Appleby. I chair the creative sector group. My question is a very simple one, and it's actually confirmed something that I think you all said earlier. My understanding is that as the people who are likely to be the mayor, elected as the mayor, you are expecting more than an advisory dotted line relationship from the thinking within the LEP into your cabinet and into your structure. You are all nodding. Are you nodding as well, Leslie? If you can all confirm that that is the case, that's an important thing for me to know. You're all confirming? Thank you very much.
Okay, so let's consider that one dealt with and go for this. And I'm going to give you 2 minutes each because we've only got 10 minutes left.
Who wants to go first? I'm happy to. Darren, do you want to start as well last?
Sorry, no. Could you repeat? Because I was barking at him.
Oh, yeah.
Awkward.
How do you
attract businesses and investors into the area?
Okay, by thinking long term. I think the really exciting stuff that's going on, I'm sure you were all on a number of mailing lists of email newsletters from around the world, around the tech and creative sectors. There's some amazing visionary thinking going on. We pick out Elon Musk as just one person who's going in there and challenging the future of work about how we're going to change society. So Bristol and Bath talks about itself being a cutting edge economic area. If we are genuinely going to be cutting edge and we're going to invite the kind of investment that is big and long term, it's about saying we want to be looking 50 years ahead, not surviving the next couple of years. So I think that if we had a question last night about what we're going to call ourselves, you know, the Northern Powerhouse or the whatever else, overnight I was thinking, are we the Western Pathfinder? And for me, that pathfinder is the route to the future economy. If we're very clear about that future economy, investment will follow.
Great, thank you. Leslie.
Thank you. Very quickly, I would go back to my first point about equality, because if you look at this area, black people earn 10% less than white people, and women in this area earn less than men. Not only do they earn less than men, but they earn much lower wages than women do right across the country. I don't know how we got there, because that's discrimination. And for all these practice politicians and all these people that sit on big bodies, I don't know what they've been doing to change that. Not a lot, it would seem. So if you look at Amsterdam, you look at the diversity of culture in Amsterdam, you look at the diversity in business, it's one of the richest cities across Europe. And that's because it has looked at equality, it's embraced it, it's embraced different people, it's embraced different skills, and it's succeeded. One of the biggest economic drivers to success is that social well-being, or that equality side of it, and that's what we've got to look at. Once we've got that, then we'll attract more money, because what people don't like to see is discrimination. They don't like to see inequality, and they don't like to see things that are not fair. And that's what I stand for, and that's what I'm going to fight for. And that's not just for one section of the community, it's for the whole lot.
Great. I'm going to remind candidates that the question is, how are you going to attract investors and business to the region? John.
And of course that's the right question, and you can only do it by creating confidence. And we in the Bristol Initiative worked hard from over 30 years ago to try to make the place better. You have to improve the whole milieu. The education facilities have got to be right. We've got four great universities. But you've got to create a story that gives people confidence about wanting to put their money here. When we started the initiative in the mid-80s, there wasn't a single crane over the skyline of Bristol. We in business, a great group of business people, working with a then very cooperative city council, created the confidence to start people thinking about investing. $500 million into Cabot Circus in the end, $500 million into Harbourside and many others. But you've got to create a credible confidence. That's a big part of the job.
Thank you. Tim?
Thanks. Jerome, thank you for repeating the question, because I was forgetting it to some of my friends here. The answer is actually something the mayor can affect. If we look at what those powers are, everybody I talk to in business tells me that our transport system is holding business back. Our lack of housing is holding people back in terms of coming into the area to provide the people that we need to work in our industries. Our infrastructure does need investment, and we do need that business support. So I think the mayor can make a real difference by actually addressing the cause of what's involved in the overall remit, and by putting those together, we can make a real difference for you. So yes, the region is strong, it is attractive, people want to come here, but we've got to actually open the doors up even more, and make it even more attractive for everybody. And it's something we can deliver as a mayor.
Great. Fine, Stephen.
Well, I agree with Tim that we've got to deal with the factors that hold us back, which are transport and housing. And those are the direct policy levers that the regional mayor and the combined authority will have. But I think the most powerful opportunity that the regional mayor is going to have is the soft power of being an evangelist on behalf of our region. I mentioned in my introductory remarks that far too few people know that this is a world-leading cluster for silicon businesses. Lots of other interesting things go on here as well. I think it was only 2 weeks ago that we had a World Congress for Virtual Reality taking place in Bristol.
Yeah.
I didn't see it. We play you a part of that.
It was banned, yes.
Other people were part of that. Great. But I didn't see it on Newsnight or Channel 4 News. Maybe I missed it because I was at
you did. It was on BBC Breakfast News nationally.
Fantastic. But it wasn't on the I bet it wasn't on the Today programme.
Yeah.
Which I can tell you. that's what policymakers listen to. No, nobody in Westminster watches. This is not a snobby
thing. Westminster watches television.
It's just the truth that people listen to other
yes.
programmes and read other newspapers. And our message about how great we are simply doesn't reach that audience for that reason. We've got to work harder at that. And I think our two cities can be a world-beating brand working more collaboratively together. We've got Invest in Bristol and Bath based behind us in this very premises, and I want to market both our cities as incredibly attractive places to live, work, and invest to directly answer your question in the future. I think you've got an amazing story to tell about what we're good at already and why entrepreneurs and inward investors look at a whole range of things. They look at the skills that are on offer, but they're also interested in, is this an attractive place to live and work as well? And I think we've got a good story to tell about marketing both our cities and why they are wonderful places.
Great, thank you. So there are two questions on Twitter that we're not going to get to because they're not specifically about creative or technology. One is around self-build and one is around citizen engagement. Candidates, I'd like urge you to go on Twitter and answer those questions directly. And I'm going to take the chair's privilege for the last question. Northern Powerhouse came up. Perhaps, Manchester, I guess, is where we see ourselves in competition sometimes in the creative tech sector. And perhaps the only way we're going to beat the Northern Powerhouse is to have a properly combined region, one authority in reality. Where do you stand on that? What's your feeling about a properly combined authority? You've got
Amen.
1 minute each.
Amen.
Go on.
Enough. That's the answer.
Great. Darren?
I want to see a proper strategy for the functional market area. The functional market area includes four local authorities that are prepared to work together. That's as far as I'll go.
Leslie. Oh, yeah.
Thank you. At the end of the day, it's about everyone working together to deliver all of this. We've got strategies by the bucket load. We have got a resilience strategy in Bristol put forward by Marvin Rees, the Labour mayor there. He's not been in post for a year, but he's making great strides. We've got these things in place. Whatever we call ourselves is going to be crucial, but let's face it, we were originally the powerhouse, and it's a term that was snatched away from us by the North West, so we need to take that back, I think.
Stephen.
Confession, I was an Avon County Councillor. I think Avon actually worked quite well in terms of service provision and having a strategic vision, including on transport. And for a lot of things that Avon councillors planned in the mid-1990s had happened without the fragmentation of the authorities in 1996, we'd now be in a completely different place. But we can't rewind the clock back to that. I would not want to recreate a single unitary council across the four councils, because they are service providers, and they can do that well close to their residents. What we have lacked is a strategic regional, sub-regional authority in order to address those sort of economic questions. And that's what we're now getting. What we're getting is not perfect. Devolution, though, is a journey, not an event. We're at the start of that journey, and I'm ambitious for getting even more devolved powers, more ability to keep our own money. That's one of the points I'll be making to central government. We are a net exporter of taxes because of our success to the rest of the country. So whenever we ask central government for more investment here, we say we want some of our own money here, please.
10 seconds,
and in
Stephen.
The future, I think maybe this sub-regional authority does need to get a bit bigger. It certainly needs to include North Somerset, but actually should really include Wiltshire, Somerset and Gloucestershire as well, because our region, West of England, is bigger than it's currently defined.
Tim.
So Thank you. We had one very quick answer for Paul, and that was yes. And the answer to your question is yes. The real purpose of this role is to cut across boundaries and think collectively and think as a region. Therefore, if we're going to succeed specifically, particularly with sectors like this, we can't look at boundaries. We have to have a broader view. So yes, we must, when it comes to creative tech, to business, to be able to look further afield. We need to be thinking north, south, east and west, and working as a team together with all of that. So yes, a simple answer.
Yeah, great. Thank you very much to all the candidates for giving up their time and sharing their thinking with us this morning. Thanks to the audience for turning up, and thank you to Engine Chef for hosting, and have a lovely day. Thank you.